Thanks. Okay, welcome everybody. Good morning. Today already day 6. What we're going to do is basically do a summarization of what we've learned so far, and just go through it in one direction. I've put in this day, so that means the rest of the days are shifting a little bit later, but it doesn't really matter because I had some slack built in anyway. So it's just shifting a little bit compared to the original plan I showed. I'm going to show a little bit about the GitHub pages, then do a summarize of the interactions we've been talking about, and then do a complete end-to-end example. So starting from nothing until you finally have a smart contract and can interact with it from a website. And then later on, if you have time and if you would like, then we can do sort of an interactive coding, and that I can code something live, which you can also code in the same time, and then go from there. And we'll see about that. And then afterwards, you can continue with the assignment. So that's basically the assignment from last Monday. So I saw quite a few of you already been working hard on it and published quite a few things on GitHub. So regarding the schema, I've put here in the summarize and shifted everything a day further. Okay, about the GitHub pages, to be able to show your website that you're making or have already made on a mobile phone, you need to publish it somewhere on a website on the internet. And GitHub has a quite convenient way to do that. You just have to put your HTML page on your GitHub page, and you can access it via as a website once you've configured the so-called GitHub pages on GitHub. And that's what I've done for all the GitHubs. And for your information, if you want to do that later on or whatever, you can do that over here. You go to the settings, and you scroll down towards GitHub pages, and you select the master branch. So that a GitHub page is being generated from your master branch. You can also generate it from other things, but the simplest is from the master branch. And then it says here, your site will be published on this URL. You can even attach a domain name to that URL. So that's what I've done for the Web3 examples, .com. And then you can really use it as a normal website. But this is enough to use it already, just with a small, bit longer path name. And if you go to the link you saw before, then you end up actually at the README, which is over here in GitHub. And if in one of the subdirectories you put a HTML file like this in this directory, then you of course have to add the directory over here and the name of the file, and then you can just access it and as any normal website. One thing you have to take care of, there's a small delay. It takes 20 to 50 seconds until your site is updated once you've uploaded it to GitHub. So if it doesn't change immediately, don't worry, just wait a little bit. Have anybody tried that already? Some have?
Yeah, you just put the /test. At the URL.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Did you put HTML behind it? Okay, well, can
I just get this page?
Okay.
Normal page.
Okay.
If you click on the
file. Okay. Now we'll figure it on after the figure it out later on.
Yeah, sure.
It should be possible. This one. small summarization of what we've been talking about. Basically, we've investigated this entire area. We've looked at the Ethereum blockchain. We've seen several instances of the blockchain, and we've seen how to create a smart contract on the blockchain. Then we've checked the interface here, how to access the blockchain via the RPC interface, and you've made some RPC calls on different ways. And then we've seen on this side, on the client side, how to access that interface using the Web3.js module. So basically here we have three kind of languages. This is the entire Solidity domain. So you write Solidity in here. This is the JavaScript domain. And this is also kind of a language, the RPC domain. Yeah, which you don't really use all that much. But so it's basically you write either this or this and combine those two. So how many blockchains have we looked at already? Actually, we've seen about 10 different instances of blockchains. So it's all the Ethereum blockchain, but it's all in different variations of it. So it's testnets, it's mainnet, it's running local on your PC, it's running on the internet. Hey, have you been aware that we've been looking at so many different variations? Can you figure out where you are, on which blockchain you are? I like it to have a lot of options and to be able to switch it depending on what you want. If you want to go fast and you want, then the local network is pretty good. If you want to make it more permanent so that you can continue on it later or publish it to somebody else, then it's better to use a test network where it's stored permanent. And if you want to go to production, you go to the mainnet, but yeah, we haven't done that yet. Now we've also used different clients to access the blockchain. Also quite a lot of variations already. We started, of course, with the Play Ethereum, and that's one of my favorites because it's so easy and you don't need that all that much to use it. Then we went to the Remix, which was more complicated, and you have debuggers and you can use all the functionality of Ethereum, of Solidity. So if you want to do slightly more advancing, then this is the best way to use. Then we've used all instances of RPCs from different ways, starting at basic curl and also via websites. And then we ended up at the Web3.js interface, starting at node.js, and then saw it also within the browser, injected by MetaMask, which we're not going to use. And the ones we're going to use is the one in HTML and or the one in the developer console to figure out things. And in the next lesson we are going to add even more clients to this because these clients are basically more interactive. You have to copy paste a lot, and the next ones we're going to use that are easier if you want to make something like with continuous integration and for the larger projects that you don't have to copy paste every time and you just can automate it a little bit more. But it just builds from these types of clients. So if you compare this amount of blockchains with this amount of clients, you have about 100 possibilities of things to access the blockchain. So it's easy to get confused if you're not careful. Yeah, then the connection, which was in the middle of the blocks, there we've also seen a couple of possibilities. The basic one is the HTTPS, but we've also used the secure web sockets, which is useful for to keep the connection open and get a continuous flow of data coming in. And with the website, basically we're using the same kind of RPC protocol, but then we're going through MetaMask. So then you're putting in your code the Web3 dot given provider, which is the provider from MetaMask. So there you also have three options to choose from. Okay, we've also seen the same function in the three environments that I was talking about, in the blockchain itself, in the client, and also in the RPC call. So basically it's the same functionality, but it's named slightly different on different places. So what I try to make a summary of it, to see how the names map from one environment to the other environment. So if you look here at the smart contract, you have to look, oh, by the way, next sheet is about the same functions but then with ETH transfer, but now for only done the transactions without ETH transfer, otherwise the slide would be too large. So here you have the basic functions, you have the constructor and the fallback function and the normal functions in between. If you look back to the constructor, how is a contract being made and the constructor being called? That's done by a transaction. That's either a normal transaction or a raw transaction. And the raw transaction is basically the same as the send transaction, only the raw transaction is signed before on your client side, and the transaction that's basically being signed by MetaMask or by the node itself. Ethereum node. And what's the Web3 version of that? We haven't really talked about that, about this function, but just to let you know, this one is called contract deploy, which sent behind it. Well, if you go to a normal function, you also use basically at this level the same functions. So it's also a send transaction or a send roll transaction. And from here it's there was this difference indeed. I've split it over here. There's a difference if you want to have a read-only function, or if you have a function that stores something on the blockchain. So as you remembered, at this level, the difference was at the call or the send. With the send, you send ETH or gas, at least gas, and it's being stored. And this is the read only. And it maps at the lower level at here at the ETH call. And over here, it ends up at the functions that are few or pure. So these are the read-only functions. And if you want to use a function where you store something on the blockchain, then you use the send and this transaction. So this connects to one another. Is it clear? Does it help a little bit? Or is it more confusing? It helps. Okay, now we are going to use the ones with ETH transfer. So that once you transfer some ETH, then you always have to write to blockchain, otherwise it isn't stored. So you don't see the call functions in here anymore. So it's all right. So basically you see it's all the same things over here. It's always a send transaction or a send roll transaction. And over here you send, if you want to send ETH, you have to add something with value behind it in the send. So it's the same over here. So So if you deploy a contract, you can also send some ETH with it, provided this one is called payable. So then it ends up over here. And of course, for the normal functions, they also have to be payable to be able to send ETH to it. And even the last one, the fallback function, also has to be payable, otherwise you cannot send any ETH towards it. So these are all the possibilities you have from the...
What did the fallback function do again?
Yeah, the fallback function is basically for two things. It's one, when you only send ETH and don't want to do a function. So here you, yeah, you just send ETH. So you don't want a call function, so you have to, it has to end up somewhere, and it ends up over here. And that also means that if you send ETH, you can also do something here. But you, there's a limit to the amount of gas that you have over here, so you cannot do all that much, but you can do, I think you can do an emit for a lock emit. But that's about the maximum that you can do. And the second is, if you call a function over here and the function isn't known by the smart contract. So because it's a permissionless system, everybody can call any kind of function. So they can just try to call a function over here. And there's just an if then else, it searches for the function names. And if it doesn't find it, it just goes back to the callback function. Yeah.
And if you don't have the callback function, what or fallback function, what can happen then? Can like the function call be gone or something? Or
yeah, then the function gets an error message. So it's, I think it reverted. So yeah, the calling contract calling program gets an error message. And if you want to send ETH and you don't have a payable fallback function, you can send ETH to it.
Okay. Yeah.
And sometimes that's exactly what you want, because that can also prevent you from errors. If you accidentally send ETH to a contract and the contract doesn't have a function to get it out, then it stays there forever.
Yeah. Okay.
So that's, yeah, how it's being used. Why they've created exactly like that, I don't know, but it's the way it is. Now, when we're in the entire Solidity world, basically you can also do the same things. So from one contract, you can call functions to another contract. Yeah, you have the same kind of functionality over here, only you use slightly different names. So you have to use the Solidity equivalent to do that. So you can also create contracts. From one smart contract, you can create another smart contract. I've shown, I think, one example with the factory of a smart contract. So you do that using new and the name of the contract that you want to create. And then it creates a new contract and calls the constructor. And if you want to also send ETH with it, then you have to add dot value to it. We haven't really experimented with it, but just that you know that it's possible. You can just call a function in another smart contract, and then you have to name the other smart contract with the name of the function, and then it just ends up over here. And you can transfer ETH to it with, for example, transfer. There are some other possibilities also, when we'll come to that. But that ends up over here. And you can also transfer ETH to a normal contract. So that's the same function back to the normal contract. We've seen a couple of examples with that, and some of you have already experimented with that also. And of course, you can call a function which is internal, so which is in the same contract, and just you call the function name and it returns to the internal contract. Yeah, and if you want to call function, I'm back to the previous slide now. If you want to call function over here, it has to be either public or external. Otherwise, you cannot call it. And for the internals, you have this one, internal or private. So to be able to call this one, this is also either public or external. And yeah, it can be payable or not payable. It's both possible. Questions about this? Okay. Yeah, one of the details is that when I was experimenting with one of your test, what do you call it? One of your assignments, which calls a lot of information from Infura. If you do a lot of calls to Infura, finally Infura says, well, there are too many calls. So the rate request is exceeded, and then you get error messages like this in your developer console. And you can fix that by signing up at Infura and get a developer key, and then over an API key, and then you add the API key to the http://infura.io/blah blah blah. And then you can get a lot more requests. I saw some of you have done that already. Who has done it already? One over there? No? Okay, well, some you'll notice when you get those error messages, and then you'll just go and do that. Now I'm going to do an end-to-end example, and starts with basically just a blank PC without anything. And at the end we have a mini website and a smart contract. So we are going to deploy a smart contract, use the gateway and use it from the browser. So actually it's this path we're going to take. Okay, well, you do need the browser. I haven't showed that, but the first thing that you have to do is install MetaMask. And this is where you find it. And you install it, get started. You create a wallet. You create your password. And you write down your backup phrase, very important. And then you have MetaMask installed. And you can see it over here. Okay, once we have MetaMask, we can choose different networks. So we have chosen Robson over here. And by the way, Robson is named after the metro station, Robson in Sweden. Okay, when we just installed MetaMask, we don't have any ether yet. So that's the first thing we have to do, otherwise we can't do anything. So luckily for Robston, that's why I've chosen it, it's easy, because well, within MetaMask, you can just click on these buttons and you get some test ether from Robston. Okay, now we have some ether, we can use it, and we are going to create a smart contract. Then you need a smart contract. Yeah, development environment, and I'm using a very simple one, the Play Editor. And if you initially start it, it already shows a small smart contract, and you can start using that already. Now I've changed it a little bit to be able to show some more things about it. So I've taken the one default contract, and I've added a log, event log thing, so we can store something in the event log. And I've added a return over here in the set function, and in set function I also emit something to the log, so we can get that later on. And the get I just left like that, so that it's a read-only function. So this is a writable function, and this is a read-only function that you can see at from the word view. Yeah, I stored the source on GitHub, and you can copy it from GitHub, and you just paste it in the editor, and it automatically compiles your source. And when it's compiled, and if it doesn't compile, you get error messages, and when it compiles, you see something like this, and you can publish it. So then you click on the publish button. And you get a pop-up message from MetaMask to confirm that it's all right to publish, because when you publish you have to pay some ETH to do that, so you want to make sure that it doesn't go automatically, and you're going to store something on a blockchain permanently, so you don't want to really do that by accident, so that's why you have to confirm it. So you confirm it to MetaMask. Is being deployed. You can see that from here, if you click on this icon, you see contract deployment going on, and finally it's deployed. And now it's published. Yeah, you see it. Yeah, now it's published on the blockchain, and now you could go to Etherscan, which I didn't show in the slides, but on Etherscan you can look about everything that's on the blockchain. And you can see there's a smart contract over there, and you can see all the interactions with the smart contract. And it also shows you the smart contract address, which I've also put over here. Now, if you later on want to interact with the smart contract again, you can use the same environment, paste the source again, and connect here to the smart contract, or press connect. And you put in the contract address in here, and you press connect. And then you're connected to the contract again. Now this environment has automatically created some small user interface around your smart contract, which you can use. So for example, the set function here, which was setting a value, which is stored on the blockchain and you can retrieve later on. Here you can enter a value, or use the slide bar to enter the value. You press on the this button, and you see a MetaMask pop up again. You have to confirm it. You see it if you press on the MetaMask icon. You see it pending, and it waits a little while, about 20 seconds or something, and then it ends up at being confirmed. So now we've stored this value, and we can check the value by using the get function. And once we've done the get function, we see the same value, 55, so we see it's really being stored. So basically everybody around the world now can go to here, use that contract, and see that value. if it's still at the same value. Summary that this is the path we are progressing. Yeah, the Rubster network, so there's one of the networks living on this location, and to access it you can use the Infura gateway, which basically allows you access to the blockchain. You have to use a URL to get there, and for Robston it's this one. Now the first thing we're going to do is use a low-level RPC call to access the get function. So how do we do that? We take the string get, we put it in this website. So that basically creates a hash out of that name, and you get this hash. So put it over here, and you take the first 8 characters out of that hash. So that's these characters. Then in the meantime, you download curl, which is a tool to do a RPC connection to the to a blockchain. Then we are going to look up our MetaMask address, because you always need an Ethereum address to interact with the blockchain. So I'm using the one from MetaMask. You can find that over here. If you click here, you see this pop-up and your account. And if you hover over it, it says copy to clipboard, and then you can, by clicking on it, copy it. So now we've collected 3 things. We have the MetaMask address, we have the contract address we want to interact with, and we have the function that we want to call. So we take those 3 and we combine that into parameters for the curl command. And I've put it here in a small Windows batch file. So here we use the from, that's this address. So that's the originator of the transaction that we want to do. That's our own address, Ethereum address. Then we're going towards the contract address using the data, which is the function we're gonna call. And the RPC call that we want to do, that's eat call. So eat call is for to call read-only functions. And then we have to wrap it into a JSON RPC envelope, which is basically called JSON RPC 2.0. And here the method you want to call with the parameters and some ID that you have to add. So this takes the line above, and this also takes. This request takes this one, so this eat call, and the parameters here is this part. So this is also a piece of JSON, and it basically combines the from and the to and the data that you want to send, and it adds here latest. So that means that we want to have the latest information of the blockchain, so the status of the last block of the blockchain. If you would want, we could also get the status from a previous state. And then we have to specify a specific block number in here. But for this example, the latest is fine. Okay, then we combine all those parameters and put it in a curl command. And the curl command, curl basically just does a HTTP request to the Infura web server. It uses this content type application JSON, so that it knows that it's JSON and also should return JSON. Uses the data parameter, so that means it's going to post the data and it's going to call this address. Now then we get this, so oops, all this thing is basically to create one big command, and this is the expanded command. So if you see, it's quite long and lots of these things. So it's long, but when you call it, you get back something like this. It's a similar format as this, JSON RPC, and the number and result. And you can, just have a look at the result, and the result is lots of zero, and then finally 37. And 37 is hexadecimal. As you can see, it starts with 0x, and 0x indicates hexadecimal. So if you take 37 hexadecimal, it's 3 times 16 plus 7, so that's 55. So indeed, we get the value 55 back. Is this clear to everyone? It's a bit of a summary, but maybe a little bit boring, but just to show you again how everything works. Okay, now we're going to use the next step and access it in JavaScript. And then we need node.js. So we're going to install that. And first we need to know a few interesting functions from JavaScript, which are not always used. So a small summary. One of the interesting things is the async function async function, and you can use that to call a function where you have to wait for the result, and in the meantime while you're waiting, the rest of the program can continue doing other things. So here's an example on how to use it. We are using the function fetch, which just calls this address and waits for the results, and it can be 1 or 2 seconds or whatever. And this way it waits for the answer to come back, and then does the next function and also waits for the answer. And to be able to use await, you can only do that from within an async function. So I've wrapped around this route in this construction with async before it. And then I call the async function. And when you call this, this waits a little while until it gets the answer. And in the meantime, any code that's below here that can continue executing. So you have sort of two things going on in parallel. Another interesting thing in JavaScript is the template literal, where you, if you want to, especially for debugging, that's interesting. You write a string, and within the string you can address variables, other variables. So you use that, do that with this construction, with the dollar and the curly brackets. And you can just connect or show any variables in there. Now we are going to use a package, a web3.js package, which is a JavaScript based package, to interact with the blockchain. So it basically makes the commands you want to use a bit easier to use. But first you have to install it, of course. It's being installed with this command, npm install -g web3. And the -g means that it's installed globally, and globally means it can be used in every directory in your system, but to use it in the directory that you want, you first have to do this command and link it to the current directory that you're running in. And once you have that, for example, you can start node and then do a mini command to use this module. So I require the module, so that basically means loading the module. I create an object and I show the version of it, which is 1.2.4, which is the current version. So now I have the module installed and it's working. And as we noticed, getting this installed was the most difficult thing, because about half of you had troubles installing it. So for Linux, they had to do they had to install the node slightly different with the node version manager. And for Windows, there are a few couple of instances where there were some Windows updates being stuck half installed. So that was fixed by rebooting the PC. But finally, I think everybody has got this installed. Yeah, now we're going to try to access the functions, the Solidity functions from JavaScript. And to do that, we have to know exactly what are those functions. So we need some kind of definition of those functions. And the definitions are stored in so-called ABI, the Application Binary Interface of the Solidity. So every time when you have Solidity, you also have the ABI. So it's just actually output of the compiler, of the Solidity compiler. And if you look in the Play Editor, then it's stored over here. You press on this button, the output.json, and then you see actually it's a pretty large piece of data, and it contains the ABI. Now then you can copy the ABI that you want, and we first going to use the get function, which was the read-only function, which is one of the simplest in it, and you just copy it, and we're going to use it later on. As you can see over here, it has the name get, of course. There are no input parameters. If there were input parameters, then you would have more information over here. And we do have an output parameter, which is of this type, uint8, and it does not have a name. Output parameters can also have a name, but this one doesn't. It's not a payable function, and it doesn't change the state, so it's a view function, and it's a function, of course. Yeah, now we are putting that into some JavaScript, and actually this piece is the piece that you just saw before. Now we need a couple of extra things. Let's see, this also works. This is the reference where the Solidity is located. First we have to import the library again. The package, the web3 package. And then we have to connect to the blockchain, the Robston blockchain in this instance. So we're using the HTTP path, HTTPS path to Infura for Robston. Okay, then we define the ABI here that we can use later on. And then we are using an asynchronous function because we want to use the await function. So I've just called it F, random name, and I'm calling the function over here. So when this starts, it starts over here, then goes to here and calls this. Now we want to call the contract, then we need the address of the contract, and I've copy-pasted it over here in this variable. And we need an address to work with. So I'm getting the address over here, and I'm creating a contract over here. So here, that's a call to the library, which just creates a contract object. you will give it as a parameter the ABI that you want to use and the address that you want to use. And then I'm here calling the contract, which is called get, and it knows this name from over here. And I call it, so that's the read-only variation. And I, if there's an error, it ends up over here, so I catch the errors. And then whatever comes back in here, I give the result over here. So if I run it, in this case I've run it from the command line, just start node with the JS file you've just created, and I get the results, which was 55 as before. Okay, now we've created our first JavaScript file to interact with the blockchain. So that's perfectly usable when you're running your software on a server. So for backend processing or those kinds of things, that's quite useful. But for frontends, for users, for web interfaces, that's not the most useful thing to do. And for user interfaces, you usually want to have a browser. So we want to make it accessible via the browser, and we want to use the same module, but then from a browser. And to be able to use a node module from a browser, you have to do some slight actions. And what you can use is a tool that's called Browserify, and that actually makes a package compatible with the browser. So first we're going to install the package, which we had done before already. We are going to install Browserify, that's the tool, and we are going to call that tool with a small input and output. And the input I've shown over here is basically just one line, and it just says require Web3. So it imports the library Web3, and it creates a new .js file, and that file you can import in your HTML file and then use the library from there. And once you've generated this, you can import it like this, but then you have to have your browserify.js in your directory where your HTML file is located, but you can also use it from a random place on the internet. And I've put a copy of it over here, so you can, if you include this part in your script, then you can use it. In the previous example, I just use HTTP and not HTTPS, and when I was experimenting with it, I saw sometimes you get an error message that your page is loading in HTTPS while the underlying page is loaded via HTTP, and the browser then doesn't like that for security reasons. So it's better to use HTTPS over here. Who has tried to use the Browserify? You have? Did it work? Okay. Nice. And the rest has used this way? Or have you used other ways to include the file? So somebody has put a copy of this in its directory on GitHub. But there are of course different ways to do. Okay, now we're going to a slightly more complicated call, and that's the call for set. So that's a write function, and we also want to retrieve the log files that it's making. So then we need the entire ABI and not just the small piece that I used before. So from here I'm copying it completely. And as you can see, there are basically now four pieces of ABI. The first piece over here, that's the one about the log emits. So it specifies how that works exactly. Then we have one piece for get, and we have one piece for set. And there's actually a fourth one, which is called stored data. And if we don't have the source here. Yeah, actually a stored data, that was a public variable. And a public variable, for a public variable, there's also automatically created a function so that you can access the public variables. So that's why there are three functions, while we only actually made two functions ourselves. Now I'm putting this in the HTML file, so making a website out of it. I start here with including the library, so I can use the library. Here I'm just showing some information, and here I've created a mini logging function. So if you want to log something, you can call this function log, and it stores it in this field, so you just see on the screen what's happening. Now then I've put the entire ABI in here and I have an asynchronous function again, which is being called over here. This is the piece of the ABI for the log. And as you remember, the log contained three parts: the message, the caller and the value. And if you look in here, there's also three parts here. One for the message, one for the caller, and one for the value. And also the types, the string is over here, and the address over here, and the uint over here. So this is corresponds exactly to this. And even the name here, that's the name that corresponds over here to the event name. So here's the one for the get that we saw before. Here's the one for the set, and set, yeah, as you can see, also has an input parameter. So now we have here the part input that also contains some more information. So it contains the type here, it contains the name of the variable here, x. Payability, it's not payable, and the state mutability is called non-payable, but it doesn't say view, so it is mutable, but it's not storing it, but it is changing the chain. Here's the last piece, that was for the public variable, and it just creates a function out of it with the same type over here. Yeah, and now name, and it's a view function. Now I'm going into the asynchronous function f, and I've chopped it up in four pieces. And the first piece, these are the next three. The first piece is to prepare. First, we need the Web3 object again. And it has to connect to the blockchain. And now we are running in a website and where we have MetaMask, so we can use the provider for MetaMask. And we do that like this, the web3.given provider. And when you in MetaMask choose a different network, then below the water, basically, this value changes. So then it goes to a different URL. Now we want to be able to access the accounts that we need from MetaMask, and MetaMask previously just gave all the accounts it had, but some time ago they made some security measures around it to prevent just requesting those accounts or just getting those accounts. You have to request them, and that means that the user has to allow it to happen, and you can request them with the function each request accounts. But each request accounts is a pretty new function which is not completely supported yet in the Web3 library, but luckily the Web3 library is extensible, so that's what we're going to do here. We're going to call this function the extend function, and that explains to Web3 there's a new RPC call that it also can use. So this is the name of the RPC call, and it has zero parameters, and within our JavaScript we want to use it as the same name, just to keep it simple. So over here now I can call this function, and with a wait, because it takes a while, and then you get a pop-up for the user, and the user has to allow the access, and then it continues. In the meantime, I'm showing here the Web3.version to show that we have access to the Web3 package, so that it works. I get the accounts, and the result. In the result over here, it contains the account information. So I'm showing that here on the screen. And I'm actually using it. Yeah, we can connect to the contract. It looks a little bit like the Node.js version we had before. So we need the contract address again. So I put it over here. And we need to create an object within Web3 to access the contract. So we use the ABR we saw before and the address. So now we have the object. First we're going to call the get function. So this was the object we just defined, and we're using the method. This is a standard word, and we're using the method get, and it knows the word get from the ABI, so then it automatically creates the possibility to call this. With get we don't supply any parameters to it, so it's just like this. And then we are using call behind it, and call is for the view only functions, which get is. Then we have to add from which address we're calling it. So I'm using x0, so that's the first address that's available in the array. And in MetaMask you only get one address, so that's also the one and only first address. Here's some error handling. So I wait for the result, and I show the result over here. And now I'm saying also to wait some while, but it's actually not for this one, but that's for the next one. It's clear so far. Now we're going to use the set functions, and that's the write function. It's more or less the same. It's also this object with methods and then with set. With set we can use a parameter, so I'm using the value of 6 to set the value of 6. And instead of call, now I'm using send. And send is used for the write functions. I also need a from address. and some error handling over here. And then I get a result back, and the result that I get back, that's a large struct with all kinds of information about this transaction. It only returns when it's really stored on the blockchain. It hasn't been really confirmed yet. As you know, on a blockchain, you should normally wait a couple of blocks to really be sure that it's 100% safe on the blockchain. So I'm ignoring that now a little bit and just take the first answer from the blockchain and working on that, continue to work on that. And within the struct that we get returned over here, also over there is the emit log information that we put in there. That's also stored in there. So we can easily retrieve that. It's in this parameter, it's in the events part, and it knows this name log because that's stored in the ABI. If there would be more events, then you could also use the other names like this. So you can access it here, and then you take the return values, and there are all the return values which are stored on that log. And then you can show them. Last time I showed, you can use decoded, so this result, and then use it as an array, as a 0, 1, 2. But I also noticed you can also use it with the names that are specified in the ABI, so this is actually more readable. So the three values which are stored on the blockchain are being shown on the screen now. Now, what we also would like to know is the return value of the function. And in that function, I returned the value that I put into the function, so it's just a value of 6. And it turns out that in Ethereum, that's not so easy to get that value back. So you have to do lots of complicated things to do that, but you can use an approximation to do that, and that's calling the same function again, but then instead with a send, you use the call option, so that's the read-only option. No, otherwise it's the rest. And if you use this one, then you get a value back that's directly a number in this case. So you can show that over here, and that's just a value of 6. But for your web interface, it's best to use the first method to get values back. That's the most reliable way. Skip forward to the result, and then I'll go back. So this is the output of the screen, the version number, the account. As you can see, it's 2 times the same account. As you can see, there's, by the way, different with here are some capitals and here are no capitals. Does anybody have any idea why the difference is there? Or any idea why it might be useful to use capitals? Now, I haven't explained it yet, but it's a clever trick they've done to create some error correction. You know, if you type in your bank number on the, if you do transfer some money, traditional money, and you type in your IBAN number, then there's some error correction in it. If you type a wrong digit, then it says there's something wrong with your number. Are you aware of that? That's there. Yeah, there's some error correction, basically to prevent mistakes. And in the normal, wrong button. Yeah. In the normal addresses, there's no error handling. So if you change just one digit, then it's yet another completely valid address. And if you send E to it, then your money is gone. So somebody has thought about it and said, well, most of the time there are some letters in it. It hardly ever happens that there are only digits in it. So if we take those letters and we make some capital and some not capital,